In the first video of this series, I talk about ancient Eurasians and Native Americans, two populations that owe a part of their ancestry to something that I call West Eurasians. I presented this idea of the West Eurasian by evoking to the older sort of scientific concept of the Caucasoid, a term that hasn't managed to translate into any kind of modern sound scientific terminology. This is because the fact that this term, the Caucasoid, was originally exposed by sciences such as anthropology and ethnography that have had massive revamps and now define the concept of race as a social construct rather than an empirical body of data. Because of these revamps, these sciences no longer accept vague terminology nor anything that doesn't allow for a certain degree of replicability, right? In any case, however, there is a legitimate argument to be made on the genetic linkage among the populations of Europe, the Middle East, North Africa, South and Central Asia, and the Americas, whom show a higher degree of genetic affinity to each other than to other modern human populations across the globe. This genetic information can be expressed as autosomal data and even visual in the form of PCAs through haplogroup cladograms, and it can be observed in the archaeological and the fossil record, and even the physiology and the ethology of human populations. The terminology of the West Eurasian is now a proper locution that finds itself being publicized in several fields across many different subjects, but especially in archaeogenetics. To understand how this ensued, we need to look at a very specific episode of genetic bifurcation between two lineages, one that is related to haplogroup M and another that is related to haplogroup N. These two lineages are correlated to the degree of West and East Eurasian ancestry among ancient and modern populations, with some caveats that complicate things. We are not so sure where this schism took place, but it's perhaps one of the most well-differentiated and more evident episodes of genetic separation in the history of mankind, which makes it very, very useful. There are two main theories to explain how this ensued. One that suggests the notion that this separation took place in Africa, where an originally monolithic population, partially related and descended from haplogroup L3, divided into two waves of migration, one that left through what is known as the Southern Dispersal, from the Horn of Africa to Arabia into South Asia, and then spreading throughout the rest of Eurasia. After that, the remaining subclades of haplogroup N left the African continent in a separate migration, leading up to West Eurasians. The other theory suggests the notion that this divide took place in Eurasia, where an originally monolithic population divided into two, one migrating west, becoming West Eurasians, and the other migrating east, becoming East Eurasians, in what is known as the Asian or the Eurasian divide. There are arguments to be made both in support and opposition of both theories. Some are related to the degree of admixture with archaic humans, such as Neanderthals and Denisovans. Other arguments are related to the presence or absence of very basal strands of certain haplogroups in the genome of these populations. And some others are related to the very specific archaeological evidence of migration and how this could have ensued. A 2018 study by Bai and several other researchers found evidence of very basal strands of haplogroup N in remains from the Sahara. Were this to be true, it could possibly end this stalemate forever. Among paternal lineages, things are less clear-cut, but we also see a general picture where, while haplogroups C and D are monopolized by East Eurasians, haplogroup F is divided between the two, with certain clades such as G, H, I, and J being exclusive to West Eurasians, and haplogroup K being divided and being present both in ancient and modern European samples. There are some complications to this. For example, haplogroup C1A is found among also upper paleolithic European samples, and CB20 in particular is also common among more Europeans. As we will see, this paints a more complex picture than originally thought. Independently of how this division took place, what we know is that this West Eurasian population remained genetically bottlenecked for a very long time before it started a migratory chain of events with the Amarian. Culture of the Middle East that is related to the Aurignacian culture of Europe. The Aurignacian is related to the Cro-Magnon and to other Upper Paleolithic European cultures, which entered Europe around 45,000 years ago, replacing the most Syrian Neanderthal culture. The Aurignacian is perhaps the most complicated genetic episode to explain archaeologically, Because what we see is that the first anatomically modern humans remain found in Europe, being those of Oase 1 and Oase 2, show no discernible West Eurasian component, rather being entirely related to the East Eurasian populations that we see in Southeast Asia at the time and Southern China. After the Oase 1 and the Oase 2 remains, which do not belong to the Oric nation proper, we see the Ustishan remains in Siberia. For the first time in human history, with the Ustishan remains, we not only see a genetic relationship with modern-day East Asians, but also to modern-day Europeans. And this West Eurasian component in the Ustishan genome is anywhere from one-third to half of it. Similarly to the Ustishan remains, the Voyage remains from Belgium show a similar story, but this time the percentage of West Eurasian ancestry is even higher, being around two-thirds to 75% of it. The female skull from Pestero Mayor shows a similar story to the Goyet remains. All these samples show an East Eurasian paternal lineage and a West Eurasian maternal lineage, which suggests that as this West Eurasian population entered Europe, carrying the Eurasian nation culture and lithic methods with them, they met a local population that overpowered and took their technology by force. The chronology that we observe, with the Oase remains being the oldest, the Ustishan remains being intermediate, and the Goyet remains being the latest, supports this theory. When we consider that the West Eurasian population was the last to leave Africa and to enter this wider Eurasian landscape that was already inhabited by other humans, this all makes sense and brings us to the fact that today there is no such thing as a modern population that is entirely or purely descended from West Eurasians. They all carry a mixture from other populations. Whenever we see remains that are purely West Eurasian, such as some Cro-Magnon and the Garbichians, we also see a generic disparity with these Eurasian nations. Although it might not be the case, as has been said before, that this Eurasian nation population died without leaving modern-day descendants. After the Eurasian nation period ends, we start to see the Garbichian period entering Europe as a technological advancement rather than a complete replacement of the Eurasian nation. And it also enters from the east like the Eurasian nation did. The Garbichian period is perhaps the most central and the most important to the development of a common West Eurasian core and is ancestral to all modern-day West Eurasian populations. The first time that we see an individual or some kind of genetic sample that is entirely West Eurasian is with the Kostenki 14 remains, undoubtedly. The Kostenki 14 remains also exhibit for the first time in human history the alleles that are responsible for red hair in modern Europeans, and they date for anywhere from 40 to 35,000 years ago, which is very interesting because it means that this was already a staple or part of the West Eurasian genetic composition or the general phenotype of this population. After the Kostenki 14 remains, we see the Sonji remains, also from Western Russia, very close to Moscow, and are perhaps the best window to the lifestyle and to archaeological evidence of how these Garbichians lived because of the degree of conservation of the utensils and the remains and all human artifacts that are there. It's with the Sonji remains that we see for the first time in human history several staples that will carry throughout the Paleolithic and the Mesolithic, even in both Europe and the Middle East, such as human-made dwellings made from bones and wood rather than living in caves. Also, we see very interesting burial culture and sacrificial culture that will carry as well throughout the rest of the Paleolithic. And we see Venus statues that are very common and are very general staple of this West Eurasian population. The Sonji remains, the Kostenki remains, the Bessina remains, the Burankaya remains, and several other remains of this Eastern European Garbichian are known as the Pavlovian culture. These Pavlovian populations will leave Europe later during the last glacial maximum, and they will reach Siberia, where they will consolidate genetically in what we know as ancient Eurasians, the first main subdivision or the first main subclass of the wider West Eurasian genome. And they will, these ancient Eurasians will also incorporate a slight degree of East Eurasian admixture from the populations that were already inhabited in Siberia. The ancient Eurasians, these Pavlovian Garbichians, exhibit also a very high degree of proficiency in the hunt of the woolly mammoths and other megafauna of the Paleolithic, which is in contrast to other West Eurasian and Gravitian populations that simply hunted middle game, or rather had a very important degree of vegetables in their diet, which wasn't common with these Pavlovians. Similarly to the Gravitian, the populations of the Levant, Anatolia, and the Caucasus started to develop their own technological devices as a continuation of the Levantine origination culture rather than a complete separation of it. We see, for example, very obvious evidence of continuation across lithic cultures, such as the Font Ibis, the stone technology of Europe, and the Kebaran and the Mushabian cultures of Egypt, Lebanon, Syria, and Palestine. Perhaps the biggest or the most obvious evidence of continuation across all of these populations from the Pavlovian to the Kebaran and the Mushabian is the presence of these Venus statues representing the female body. We are not so sure what these statues represent or what do they mean, perhaps in worship of fertility or good omen, or it has a more visceral inner meaning to these populations, and it's perhaps a worship of the pleasures of the flesh that is ingrained in all West Eurasian cultures. While the Pavlovians managed to escape to Siberia during the last glacier maximum, the rest of the Gravitian populations that were inhabiting Europe at the time either freeze to death or managed to migrate south into Italy and Iberia, where they started the Solutrean and the Magdalenian cultures. Both cultures are Gravitians, but also are related to the Goyet orignations, representing between half to even 75% of the total ancestry of the Solutreans and Magdalenians. We're not so sure where how much these cultures contributed to the modern-day genetic ancestry or genetic composition of modern-day West Eurasians, but this could perhaps be the reason why there is so much CB20 among modern Europeans. It's around this time that we start to see the Kebaran and other populations of West Asia starting to incorporate not only West Eurasian ancestry, but also ancestry from a not-so-well-understood source. A source that is in fact older than either West or East Eurasians themselves, but it's not African. And this source has been referred by researchers as the Basal Eurasians. This Basal Eurasian component is entirely hypothetical. There is no modern population or ancient population that has been confirmed to belong to it. And it could even not exist, but simply be a limitation of the current methodologies of the archaeogenetic field. Where this Basal Eurasian ancestry did exist, or is simply noise or contamination, we don't know. But what we know is that for the first time in human history, it is around this time that West Eurasians start to exhibit a mixture with it. We see it in the Sutswana caves in ancient Georgia 30,000 years ago, all the way to the Pinarvasi remains in Anatolia, in northern Anatolia, that are much, much more recent. And despite this chronological distance, both populations show the same exact genetic ancestry, a majority of which is West Eurasian, and a very important minority of it, that is Basal Eurasian. This Sutswana / Anatolian hunter-gatherer cluster, as we could call it, is very similar to ancient Old Eurasians in the fact that it's mostly West Eurasian, but also incorporates genetic ancestry from other populations. Finally, a later population that is related to both the ancient Old Eurasians and the Anatolian hunter-gatherers / the Sutswana, but without carrying the East or the Basal Eurasian ancestry from them, but also descended from the common West Eurasians, and start to repopulate the frozen wasteland that Europe had become during the last glacier maximum, quick sorting what is known as the epigravitian period in Paleolithic Europe. These populations entered in contact with the Solutreans and the Magdalenians, which is evidenced by what we see in the Elmiron and the Pinbasan caves in southern Europe. We are not so sure how much of this genetic component is part of this new population, but these Western hunter-gatherers, as we have called to call them, they show evidence of both dark skin and, curiously, however, blue eyes as well. These Western hunter-gatherers had a lifestyle much more similar to their Middle Eastern rather than to their more gregarious Siberian ancient Old Eurasian cousins, choosing to live in caves rather than living in housings, and choosing to have more omnivorous diets in opposed to the ancient Old Eurasians who hunted woolly mammoths and other megafauna Paleolithic Siberian Europe. These three families, the ancient Old Eurasians, the Western hunter-gatherers, and the Anatolian hunter-gatherers, represent the basic building blocks on which all West Eurasian populations descend today. we know that these populations interacted with each other, but they tended to interact with each other militaristically, violently, and territorially, rather than amicably, with rape and murder being very common mechanisms of exchange. We don't see them interacting in more diplomatic means or diplomatic ways until the Neolithic and the start of the agricultural revolution, which seems to calm them down a bit. Even then, what is undeniable, though, is that despite this violent nature of their interactions, they did happen. For example, we see that in the Via Bruna site in northern Italy, which is ascribed to the Western hunter-gatherers, we see an ancient North Eurasian paternal lineage. In similar, we see a West Eurasian lineage in the Caucasus in Anatolia, which tells us of our eventualistic network of exchange and admixture that carried on all the way past the Neolithic and the Bronze Age to modern day, in such a way that modern day populations cannot ascribe their ancestry to just one of these groups or completely to West Eurasians either. They are the result of admixture. And even then, with this seemingly unaddressable sea of dissimilarity and separation, what we can find is subterfuge in the fact that all common shared traits of these populations, both ethnological and physiological, all the way to culture, tradition, medicine, and so forth, owe their similarities to a single discrete migratory event, and owe the entirety of their ancestry, or the majority of their ancestry, to a single monolithic group, West Eurasians.